I want to thank Pete. We've worked on this for a little bit and put it together, and I'm thrilled that Pete asked me to come here and be with you all today. And Pete beat me to the punch because I was going to ask how many veterans are here, but he's already done that, and I thank each and every one of you because some of you set it up so that I could serve. And there was a few I saw that were younger looking that you probably came after I retired or something, you know. But to be here with you about something that is so important, and that is making sure that we talk about men things, because we have great challenges today in our lives. You know that, and I know that. And to have the opportunity to have a group like this, this is awesome. This is truly, truly awesome. And from young ones like him, I won't even talk about the old ones, okay? I'll leave that alone. I'll look at somebody, they might get me. But Pete mentioned it, and I'm going to mention it again. In addition to the book being over there, and it is correct, it says political correctness at its worst. Let me inform you right up front. I am politically the most incorrect person in the United States of America, without question. And I know that to be true because I spoke in San Diego, California, probably 5 years ago now, maybe six. And it was a large organization out there, and a lot of retired military were in it. And after I was finished speaking, people came up, you know, and were shaking hands, talking and stuff. And I saw this one guy standing in the back. And I figured there's something up here. And after everybody else is finished, he comes up. And he says, so you think you're the most politically incorrect person in America, huh? I said, no, I don't think it. I know it. He says, well, I'm a former United States Marine. And I have always claimed that. But after today, I know I'm two, you're one. I said, thank you very much. And you know, coming from a Marine, that's a big deal right there, let me tell you, okay? But the book is here, as Pete said. But there's also two other things over there. One of them is my business card, and you're welcome to have one of those. But there's something called Psalms 91 card. It's right back here in my pocket all the time. I wish I'd had it years ago when people were shooting at me, because I think it would have helped a little. But it's part of what I do also. I'm the national spokesperson and the vice president for an organization called Operation Safety 91 that exists right here in Central Florida, created by a husband and wife. He was a priest, she was a nun. It's a long story, I could tell you sometime later. But, you know, they had to get the Pope's approval, et cetera, et cetera. And unfortunately, Ed passed away just over a year ago, so his wife is the president, I'm the vice president. Operation Safety 91 focuses on our first responders. That's what it's all about. Military, law enforcement, fire and rescue, EMS, EMT. And if there's any group of men and women out there that needs more protection, I don't know who they are, because we know what they face every day. And they do that so that we can be here like this today. And that's truly the most important thing. So that's what Operation Safety 91, that's what my Psalms 91 card's about, and it's over there. Now, this is a challenge for me today. It's a challenge because I do anything from 30 minutes to 7 hours. Yeah, I said that to Josh there a minute ago. He said, 7 hours? I said, yeah, believe it or not. And so I'm going to really talk about a couple things that I think are important. And I use a few slides, especially from the Mogadishu perspective. But for a bit, my belief on how fortunate I am in life is that I'm standing here with you today. Because in my opinion, the only reason I am here is because of the grace of God. Because I know without question that, believe it or not, this past Saturday was 22 years ago that Mogadishu happened. I know that that day I should not have survived. I did for one reason only, and that's because God said he wasn't through with me yet. And that's the reason I get to be here with you today. And I can't think of anything more important to share with people that is not about me. It's all about what he chose to do with me that day. I believe more of my Rangers are alive today because he let me live so that I could get them through that. But I promise you, on Saturday, I was on the phone, because there are certain people that I talk to on October 3rd of every year. One of them is a father by the name of Ben Pila. Sergeant Dominic Pila was his son. Ben Pila and I have misspeaking one time in 22 years on October 3rd. And that's because I was in Afghanistan at the time visiting troops and I couldn't get to him. But my wife called him for me. Ben and I talked. Ben and Diane are like family. We visited with them. We've eaten dinner with them. We go to the cemetery with them. And see, that's what it's all about to me. God chose me to survive, to get through that day so that I could be here with you today. He has a great plan for each and every one of us. We don't know what it is, and it's a good thing because we'd probably mess it up if we knew. So we don't want to know. But if we always just follow with the guidance that we know we get from Him, like we've already had this morning in prayer, it's hard to beat. It is. And I am so blessed that I have been allowed many times to speak at the church that I grew up in and other churches. And it has become truly a ministry in a way that I would have never imagined in my life. I grew up, moved to Florida, live over in Rockledge, became a member at the First Baptist Church of Cocoa, Florida, right downtown in Cocoa Village. We moved here to Florida in 1959. I was 8 years old at the time. My wife and I met in that church in 1959. We got baptized in that church when we were 10. We're members of that church again today. We've only been married 9 years. It's a long story. But a good one, right, Dylan? Yes, it is. Yes, we did. That's where we grew up. And after a few opportunities of being married, we found each other 35 years after we graduated high school. Better to be lucky than good, guys. Okay. And I promise you that, again, when I look at things and I say, boy, God had a plan I didn't have any clue of, but to bring us together. Her father and my father were deacons in that church at the same time. And now we're back there now. And of course, the church is constantly beating me up right now to be a deacon, which I told them, not yet. See, to be a deacon, I got to do it like my father did, and that means I got to be there. When somebody calls, I got to be there. It's hard to do that if you're in San Diego or if you're in Arkansas. And so I'm waiting until I'm through doing what I'm doing, and then I will take the steps that my father took. Because God has that plan for me. And it's so cool to be back in the church where you grew up. And as a matter of fact, my wife's mother, who will be 91 in a few weeks, still a member of that church. Linda's father and my father and my mother have passed away. Linda's a member in that church. Her daughter's a member in that church. And her granddaughters are members of that. We got four generations in one family in that church now. That's the reason I don't go every Sunday. I can't take it, okay? Not really. They're awesome. It's awesome. So anyway, I just want you to know that I was raised, and it's always important for me to talk about it up front, I was raised in a Christian family. That's a good way to start life. It really is. And I think if you're sitting here, you understand that. But I think what one of the things we have a responsibility to do is get other people to understand it. This is a great, great opportunity here, but we need now to reach out and get other people to understand. And I was raised that way, and I was so fortunate to be raised that way. I'll be honest with you, I didn't go to church every Sunday for almost 30 years when I was in the Army. I didn't. But it never meant I wasn't a Christian and that I didn't believe and that I didn't have my own way of still worshiping, because I did. And I think that's important that we make people understand you don't have to be in church every time just to worship, because you can worship yourself sometimes when you're somewhere else. And so I am blessed to say today that I am a better Christian today than I've ever been in my life. There is no doubt about it. And when I have a wife like I have that is so strongly that way too, boy, it makes really a lot of fun raising grandkids. And see, our grandkids, he's here at UCF. His brother's in Batesville, Arkansas, where we just went up to a small college up there, a Presbyterian college, and he's quarterback on the football team. We'll do everything we can to get him down here because he went 78 yards the other day just like that. I said, boy, you got my speed. Not really. But I got a 19-year-old and 24-year-old. Then I got a 5-year-old grandson who's, my daughter's a nurse, her husband's a deputy sheriff. That's a big deal to me. And then I got a 4-year-and-a-half-year-old granddaughter and a 19-month-old granddaughter. And the two granddaughters live 2.2 miles from the house. I know my wife told me, so that's how far she checked it, you know. But see, we also have now found that we've got a great family that we are responsible to bring up. And we're bringing them up in the church. And see, that's the reason I know with Dylan being here, it's great. Not that he's here, but I know what he believes too, and I know how he is. And that's a good thing. So I'm very proud of that. So anyway, I wanted you to know right up front, I am only here to speak with you and share some things with you because God said he wasn't through with me, and I'm going to do everything I can to make him be proud of me every day. And I think most of the time he is. How many people in here have ever heard me speak before? Just a few. Where'd y'all hear me?
Park Society.
Okay. I'm going back there in 2 weeks. Yep, I'll be there again. I know Andrew has a couple of times. Grandson don't count, okay? He says, I hear you all the time at home, you know? But anyway, I know a few of you have. But what I want you to understand is as I go through this, because I know we're going to shoot for about an hour. That's what I was told. But because otherwise, I just keep talking. But I want you to know that if you have a question when I talk about something, especially the part associated with Somalia, and if something I don't say you got a question about, you raise your hand and ask me. It will not make me lose my place because you'll find out real quick I don't have one. Okay? I'm just here to talk. So this is, in my opinion, definitely for you, and that's the way I want it to be. I am so thrilled, Pete, for you inviting me. I appreciate it so much. This picture right here is what I call a picture of the reality of sacrifice. This is a C-141 Air Force aircraft sitting on the runway in Mogadishu, Somalia, in October of 1993. The reality of sacrifice that is pictured there is you see the back end of that aircraft open and you see the members of Task Force Ranger standing there. We're awaiting the flag-draped caskets of 18 American soldiers that were killed on October 3rd and 4th. I call it the reality of sacrifice, and I always have it up front when I speak because there are people that don't have a clue that sacrifice is a reality. Because the greatest sacrifice is the reason we're all here, and that's because he sacrificed for all of us. Jesus made that ultimate sacrifice and set the standard that we have to try to live up to every day. Unfortunately, this one is real to us every day. It's happening today, somewhere. It could be in the military. It could be a law enforcement, a fire and rescue. It could be one of those first responders. We wish it never existed, but I promise you it exists and it will never go away. Because unfortunately there are people that are out there called bad people. And this does become a reality. But that is why the reason I use that as my opening slide, because people need to understand sacrifice is a reality. Those of you who were veterans and served, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And we know how many on our left and right may be sacrificed along the way that didn't make it. And that's the reason this is very important for people to understand. This slide right here is an hour and a half normally. Won't be today, obviously. And it's that important because that's the reason it's also on the front of my book, Leadership at its Best. Because I think leadership is so amazingly important. And unfortunately, I don't think we do it very well. I don't think we do it well, whether it's in our private life or whether it's in our professional life doing whatever we do. And I believe we have people in positions of leadership today that are causing us more problems than helping us. And the way we fix that is we step up and say, this isn't right, there's a better way. We have to do that. And to have a gathering like this, we can do that. We can. Leadership is unbelievably important. And what's amazing to me is people don't understand how important it is. It's quite interesting. I was speaking to a law enforcement conference, say, for instance, and I've had some great ones this past month, September. I had 6 different events. The last one was in Columbus, Ohio. That was a little challenging because that's where Urban Meyer in Ohio State's at. So, you know, I don't like him. How many Gators we got in here? Well, y'all put a whooping on Ole Miss. I'm okay with that. Don't do that to us, okay? Don't do that. But I don't know what you know about Urban Meyer, but I can tell you all the dirty things, so I'll be happy to tell you sometime, okay? Yeah, wouldn't want my kid playing for him, I'll tell you right now. Anyway, I was there, but I was speaking to a Narcotics Officers Association conference in the state of Ohio. You want to talk about people that have a challenge every day? You want to talk about people that face sacrifice every day? It's them. Well, see, when I talk, I always ask about how many leaders do I have, you know? And when it's police officers, you know, the ones that are in leadership positions raise their hand. Then I love to walk over to the young patrol officer who didn't raise his hand and say, so you're not a leader? No, sir, I'm just a regular patrol officer. I said, okay, well, let me ask you a question. If you're the first one to arrive at the scene of an accident or a shooting or something, who's in charge? And he looks at me with that, you know, 20-mile stare, like, uh-oh. I said, yeah, you're in charge. See, leadership is both formal and informal. And you know, some of the greatest leadership is the informal leadership, the people that just step up when they have to. And then I always get to ask people, well, how many of you have children? And they raise their hand. And I know a lot of you would raise your hand if I asked that question. Well, guess what? The greatest leadership you have in your life is when you have kids and you get to raise them. There is no greater leadership challenge in your life than to raise your kids. And you know that, and I know that. But see, a lot of people out there don't get that. And I think one of the issues that we have is that lack of leadership in the family that causes some of the things you and I see happening out there today. And more often than not, and I'm pretty sure that I will get your agreement on this, the leadership that's missing is a father being at home with the kids. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. We, you and I, have to make that better. And that's the reason I talk about it. That's the reason I talk about it. So see, leadership's a very interesting thing. It's not all formal leadership and all of that, but leadership is what we should wake up every morning saying, today's another day to be the leader of the family. I'll go do what I have to do. I'll do my work, but I've got to take care of the family because I and my wife, my partner, we're the leaders. And see, I take that on today when I have 5 grandkids. I got the great parents. I got parents that are doing great things for my grandkids, but I'm not about to walk away and say, nope, not my job. No, it is my job, whether they like it or not. And that's what we have to do. So don't ever think that leadership's not important. It's gigantically important. Well, that one slide, like I said, I could talk on for at least an hour and a half. I'm just going to highlight a couple of things that I like to share with people. Those values that you see there of loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, honor, integrity, and personal courage, I wish I could tell you that I created that, but I'm sure some of those people that are veterans are from the Army and they know that's where I got it from. The Army's values, those 7 values, are the basics of leadership right there. And they're not about rocket science or anything, because if they were, I couldn't do it, because believe me, I am technologically challenged. When we went to Arkansas the other day, I had a map. My grandson had his phone. We got there better with his phone than my map, okay? But see, folks, we have to understand that we're leaders each and every day, and we need to live with that in our mind. Well, of those values up there, there's just a few I'm going to highlight to you. The first one's personal courage. Personal courage in leadership, folks, has nothing to do with facing danger. Personal courage and leadership means you're a leader that is willing to make the hard right decision versus the easy wrong. Unfortunately, we have too many easy wrongs being done today. We need to make the hard, right decisions. And people will say to me sometimes, well, if it's right, why is it hard? It's hard because you may be making people change what they do and how they do it. People don't like change. They're willing to just let things go as they are. That's where leadership needs to step up and make the hard, right decisions. I will tell you that, in my opinion, what's going on with our military today is absolutely disastrous and awful. And it hurts me every time I think about it. Because the young men and women serving out there today are going to have to do the same things that was being done before. They're just not getting the support and what they need to do it. We've got the greatest military on the face of God's earth, and we're not taking care of it like we should. We need leadership that is willing to make the hard, right decisions. And they're not. It's not magic to do that. My last assignment in the United States Army was in Atlanta, Georgia, at 1st U.S. Army Headquarters. I came in to be the chief of training. Chief of training for that headquarters took care of every Guard and Reserve unit east of the Mississippi, 2,700 units. That was what I did two of my last years. I later became the chief of staff of that headquarters, but that's what I did. My predecessor, and I got to meet him and everything, was technologically brilliant. I am so technologically stupid, don't text me, because it's going to take a long time for me to text you back, folks. That's just me. See, I believe in real simple things. Well, what I found was my predecessor, when I went into the office and met him for the first time, he had his big computer behind him, and he had that laptop that's sitting there, or like that, on the front of him. I said, why do you need two computers in your office? I didn't ask him that. That's what I was thinking. I'm lucky to work one, much less two. So anyway, after he left, I had a 30-day rule when I took a position. For 30 days, I keep my mouth shut and my eyes and ears open. For 30 days. See, I've seen too many times, and probably many of you have, somebody comes in to be in charge, and they're immediately going to change everything. Well, who made them, you know, the boss so quickly that they can change everything? I don't understand that. So I waited. Well, about 2 weeks into the job, I got up from my desk and I walked out my office, and my secretary's desk was only about 15 feet from mine. And she said, sir, where are you going? I said, well, I'm going to the 10 o'clock meeting. She said, sir, that's been canceled. I said, well, didn't you think that was important to share with me? She said, sir, I sent you an email a few minutes ago. She sit 15 feet from my desk. After I came down off the ceiling, I said, let me tell you something, Laura. If you ever do that again, I will fire you. Yell at me. It's okay. Meeting's canceled, you know? This ain't rocket science, folks. But what I figured is, if she did it that way, I'll bet everybody did. And that's exactly what I found, walking around and seeing people did everything with that computer. That was it. Emails. So on the 31st day, I got in the office nice and early like I usually did. My deputy, who was a retired Navy guy, and my sergeant major came in a little bit after me, and I said, Bill, the computers have a virus. He said, what kind of virus? I said, Bill, I don't know. They have a virus, so don't let anybody turn their computers on. And he looked at me and he said, well, sir, I'll go down to the IT people and see what the virus is. I said, Bill, it's the McKnight virus. He goes, oh, okay. So after about an hour or so, I walked around to see what people were doing. They were doing just about what you are doing. Nothing, okay? Because the computers weren't working. And I checked people's telephones. I said, huh, got a dial tone. Can't you call people? Well, we need to send emails first. I said, okay. I didn't know that was the rule, but okay. So everybody left, went to lunch, came back to lunch, and I had what is better known as a come to Jesus meeting, and I was Jesus for a few minutes, okay? And I told them what I had seen and what was going to stop. I said, if I see you continuing to do that. The personal courage wasn't hard for me, but I can tell you what, people didn't like me for a while. They didn't understand why I'm going to change what they're doing. But I knew it was the right thing to do. And that was what it was all about. And I think we become 10 times more efficient that way. When we can pick up the phone, we can get up out of our chair, walk down the hall and talk to somebody instead of sending emails. I mean, there were people sending emails. He's here, and there's a petition in between. They send each other emails. Now, is that not stupid? But see, that's one of the challenges we have today. People don't communicate. I mean, I'll never forget when somebody walked in my office one day and put an email on my desk and said, "Sir, I don't like the tone of that." I picked it up and went like this. Yeah. And I laid it back down. I said, it sounds just fine to me. What don't you like about it? The tone. There is no tone to a piece of paper. See, folks, sometimes we really have to get in people's pants to make them do the right thing. That's such a simple example. Can you imagine how big some of that is, though, in places? See, we can't communicate. We're too busy emailing people. And that's not communications. My people didn't like me for a while, but they got over it. They had to. I did. That's what we have to do. We have to be leaders that will make people do the hard right thing versus the easy wrong. You know, to me, right's not hard anyway. It's really not. So that's the reason that's important to me. The other one I'm going to talk about is respect. I learned how to lead. I was very fortunate growing up. When I was 10 years old, I was a catcher on the Little League baseball team, and my coach made me understand that I was in charge. I'm 10 years old. He said, "Danny, you're the only one looking at the other 8 players, and they're all looking at you. You've got to make sure you know what's going on and everything is right. You've got to do that." Okay, coach. So I did that, and after the game would be over, my coach would take me aside and critique me. I had about 3 minutes on the good stuff, about 2 hours on the other. My first great leader was my father. He was my Little League baseball coach. I was fortunate. But I started learning about leadership at 10. I didn't know I was, but I did. In high school, I was a quarterback on the football team. I was a catcher on the baseball team, a point guard on the basketball team. That, all of those things being, you know, sports, yes, but you know what? They sure help you learn about leadership. And I promise you, those things helped me prepare to be a leader in the United States Army. There's no doubt about it. But see, that is how I first learned about leadership. I learned about the respect part of leadership because, once again, I was so blessed. In 1978, I went to the 2nd Infantry Division in South Korea. I went up there I was a young captain. I got commissioned on August the 3rd of 1973 at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Army ROTC graduate from Florida State University. On August the 3rd of 1973, because I constantly think about it, I raised my right hand, like many of you, and I swore to protect the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic. So help me God. And I promise you, if they call me, I'll go today. I promise you. And I know many of you in here would be right behind me, right beside me, and some of you might get in front of me. But we'll do that. Well, in 1978, 5 years, almost 5 years later, I go to Korea. I was a young captain. I was in an infantry battalion for a bit. The aide to the division commander, who was a 2-star general, about 20,000 soldiers in the 2nd Infantry Division at that time in 1978. His aide had to go home for a family emergency and wasn't going to be coming back, so he has to get a new aide. So word goes out, this is what we're looking for. I went to my boss and I said, "Sir, we got a couple of guys that meet the requirements." He looked at it and he said, "Yeah, you're right." He says, "Where's your name at?" I said, "Well, I don't meet one of the requirements. I haven't commanded it yet." He says, "Yeah, but you've got a great Ranger background. I've been a Ranger instructor for 3.5 years already," which was very unusual as a young lieutenant to get to do that. And he said, "The general's got a good Ranger background. Put your name down." I said, "But sir," he said, "put your name down." I said, "Yes, sir." I got interviewed along with seven other people, and I became the aide for the division commander. I had no idea how important that was going to be for this young captain that would impact the rest of my career. I went to work for him, and it was amazing. He was a 17-year-old private when he made a combat jump on D-Day with the 82nd Airborne Division. 17. He had five campaigns in World War II before he got out of the Army in 1946, and he did that so that he could complete his education, come back in as an officer. He wanted to lead. He was already leading because he was a sergeant, but he wanted to be a leader and have an impact. So in 1946, he got out of the Army. Got that education and came back in through Officer Candidate School. Not too long after completing Officer Candidate School, a year or so, he was promoted to captain. And there was this war called the Korean War. There was one combat jump made in Korean War, in the Korean War, by the 187 of the 101st. It was made at Munsan-E, and the captain that went out the door first was the person that I was working for. He led out the door first. That's called leading from the front, plain and simple. He completed his tour in Korea and then had three tours in Vietnam as a special forces advisor, a battalion commander, and a brigade commander. But when he was in Korea, I was his aide when he was a division commander. I remember one day walking on a ridgeline with him because he loved to go out and visit the troops when they were training. He hated the office. We got along so good because I'm the same way. We were walking and he stopped. And he just started sort of staring in one direction. I knew it was one of those times to keep my mouth shut, my ears open, and also watch. And I could tell he was somewhere else. He was back in the Korean War. Because after he finished, I said, "Sir, what were you thinking about?" He said, "I was remembering the day I was standing right here on this ridgeline right here with my company. And I remember looking down right there, and I saw more Chinese than I knew ever existed on the face of the earth coming at us. And I didn't know if we'd survive. I was pretty sure we wouldn't." And I said, "Well, what did you do?" He said, "Well, this was now time to not just lead, but I had to fight. And usually I was more doing the leading, making sure people are doing what they're supposed to do." He said, "I picked up my M1, and I pulled the trigger, and nothing happened." I said, "Why didn't anything happen?" He said, "I forgot to put any ammo in." I said, "That's a problem." But see, he was so focused on leading and making sure everybody else was doing everything, he just didn't do that, you know? Plain and simple. Okay. Hang myself here. Anyway, what a great man he was. And when he was a brigade commander in Vietnam, command and control helicopter, one of his units in a heavy fight, he got word that one of the lieutenants had been shot. That lieutenant happened to be his son. They said he handled it just like it was anybody else. I'm sure he did outwardly, but we know what he would be going through inward. I had the privilege to be his aide in Korea for 9 months. Then he got orders to go to Fort Benning, Georgia, and be the commander at Fort Benning. And he called me in the office and said, "Sir," I said, "I've got my orders to go to Fort Benning." I said, "Yes, sir, I know." He said, "What I want you to do is get the wife and daughter ahead by 30 days, get them all ready to Fort Benning." I said, "No problem, sir." He said, "Then, when change of command occurs, I'll go to Fort Benning. But I wanted to ask you, would you like to go to Fort Benning with me?" Well, I was born in Columbus, Georgia, so this is cool. I get to go to Fort Benning again already. And I said, "Sir, I'd love to, but I have orders to Fort Hood, Texas." I didn't say I was a smart captain, because why would you say that to the general, right? And he looked at me and he says, "You know, I don't think I asked you about your orders to Fort Hood. Do you want to go to Fort Benning?" I said, "Sir, I would love to." He says, "Okay, that's what we'll do." I said, "Well, sir, what do I do about your orders for Fort Hood?" He said, "I had them canceled 3 days ago. Don't worry about that." think he had a plan, don't you? How many people have ever heard of something called Best Ranger Competition that occurs at Fort Benning, Georgia every year? Well, it is what it is, believe me. And the name of that competition is the David E. Grange Jr. Best Ranger Competition. That's the man that I work for. Ranger extraordinaire. General Grange and I have stayed in contact, to put it politely. We see each other usually at least once a year. We've always talked on his birthday. I've never forgot to call him and talk to him on his birthday. He always talks to me on my birthday. Our birthdays are the same day, so it's pretty easy. See, God had a good plan for me. I can't miss the general's birthday because it's the same as mine. My father and General Grange are 2 weeks apart in birth. 2 weeks apart. It was like a second father. But what I learned about General Grange was leadership. Oh, it was a great time with him, but I learned about leading. Because I watched a man that's a two-star general. I watched him go out and road march with soldiers. Because that was his requirement. Everybody had to do a road march every quarter. But I watched the two-star general go out there and road march with them. See, a lot of generals put requirements and bosses put requirements out there, but they don't do them, and some of them don't even have a clue how to do them. He was the leader that led by example. How blessed I was as a young captain to learn from somebody like that. He truly, truly didn't even know how much he impacted my career from learning to lead like he did. I don't think I did it probably as good as he did, but I tried. And when I took command of the Ranger Battalion at Fort Benning, Georgia, in February of 1993, the Ranger Regimental Commander that passed the colors to me was a colonel by the name of David L. Grange. I worked for his son as well. See, I was pretty blessed. I don't think that's luck. I call it a blessing beyond belief to have that opportunity. So I learned about respect because of General Grange's leadership style, and I watched him do it, and I learned from him. See, there's two kinds of leaders that exist, good ones and bad ones. There's nothing else, folks. There's no maybes in this game. There's really not. There's good ones and bad ones. And I learned so much from so many good ones like him, but he was the best. But I also had a couple of bad ones. You know, I learned as much from them as I did from the good ones because I learned what I didn't want to do. And if you ever go through your entire life and can say at the end that I never had a bad leader, God bless you, but that ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. It's reality. It's okay. Because, you know, you can learn so much from those bad leaders of what you don't want to do. So, see, that's sort of how I look at leadership. You learn how to lead. You know, we hear people say, boy, they were born to be a leader. Folks, there has nobody ever been born with a little toe tag that said future leader in America. I think every one of us today we're born have some ability to lead. The question is, how does that develop for us? What do we get to do? What do we choose to do that gives us the opportunity? Many of you sitting in here know exactly what I'm saying because you've lived it and you've done it. I love having the young ones here because I hope you hear what I'm saying, because it's important. Your day will come. And when it does, just hang on to it as long as you can. It's a great, great thing to get to lead Americans. It really is. I hope you never have to lead them in a situation like I did, although some of you probably been there and done that too. But if you're called upon to do it, step up and do it. Because the one thing in this room I think that's most important is we always have the greatest guidance in the world in our favor coming from Him. Plain and simple. I never questioned that. I never did. So that's what's so important up there, and all of those things we could go on and talk about forever, but we're not going to. Decision making is something that I find very interesting. When I wrote my book, I put the label on decisions of good, bad, and stupid. And when the manuscript came back from the first reading with three people, the number one question was, does he really want to use the word stupid? And I told my publisher, I said, George, didn't you notice that I capitalized every letter in the word stupid? Every letter is capitalized. He said, yeah, I did. I said, I want it that way because I want people to see it, because stupid decisions will cause people to die. And I can personally vouch for that one. Stupid decisions do that. And we see too much of it going on. Anyway, that's what I did with that. I'm going to talk a little bit about operations in Somalia. How many people in here read the book Black Hawk Down? Not real good at reading, okay? How many people saw the movie Black Hawk Down? Yep. Well, let me advise you. My book will never become a movie, okay? Because one thing, they could never get somebody to portray Bill Clinton as I wrote about him. Mm-hmm. No. I don't know if he liked the book or not, but I mailed him a copy anyway, you know? I was sort of hoping maybe he's passed it to Hillary by now. I don't know, you know? Because it's about leadership, folks. That's what it's about. That's what that book's really about. But anyway, I always ask that, and that is very normal. A few people read the book Black Hawk Down. I promise you, mine's an easy read. I graduated Cocoa High School. It's an easy read, okay? Believe me. Even my older brother read it, so that's pretty good, you know. But I want to talk about some things there, because I think in the time left, you deserve to know a few things you don't know. You know, you always hear about the rest of the story. And there's truly a rest of the story to this thing. That gives you a little background on when things sort of started for us, because on June the 5th, there was that massacre of United Nations soldiers. And that prompted the UN to react. And of course, their reactions are pretty pitiful most every time. They're probably the most worthless organization on the face of the earth, in all honesty. They really are. Because for one thing, they do nothing unless we help do it. You know it as well as I do. And no other country steps up more than who? Us. You know it, and I know it. But the UN's reaction to that massacre was that Mohammed Farahdeed, who was the most powerful clan leader over there, he was not the only. There were three clans over there. He was the most powerful. He'd been a very powerful general in their army when their government fell apart in 1991. Saeed Bari, the president, fell. He left. They now have a civil war and a famine going on. You want to talk about genocide? You get a civil war and you get a famine going on at the same time. That's what you end up with. So that's what was really going on over there. And Mohammed Farahdeed was the most powerful. He wanted to become the president of Somalia. Well, anyway, the UN's reaction was that they wanted him captured. It was a capture-only mission that we went on. Why was it capture-only? Why wasn't it like SEAL Team 6 with Osama bin Laden? Because it was a political thing. Boutros Ghali, who was the UN Secretary General at the time, hated Mohammed Farahdeed. They had fought each other over there on the battlefield. He saw this as a way to take him out, and the ultimate embarrassment is capture him. Don't kill him. Capture him, because you kill him, they become a martyr. He wanted him captured. That was stupid. And that was all a political thing by Boutros Ghali. So that's the first thing that I think people need to understand. It became a capture-only mission. The U.S. response was, we will do that. The United States will do that. Madeleine Albright, who was our ambassador to the U.N., said, President Clinton said, we'll do this. You got to remember, this is 1993. The Clinton administration just took over in January of 93. With all his great experience in the military, oh, that's right, he was a draft dodger, I'm sorry. We've seen the pictures of him and Hillary by the burning American flag. I'll never get over it. Never will. I've got friends that are dead today because of them. I've got friends that were in Benghazi that are dead because of them. See, leadership, folks, we need to have the right kind of leadership. That's not a political statement, because I don't do politics. I believe in being honest, though. And that's being honest with you. That's what happened, and then all this other stuff happens. Well, it was an interesting way how we got there, 3rd Ranger Battalion, but we got there. On August the 10th of 1993, 3rd Ranger Battalion, we were at Fort Bliss, Texas, we were training, and we were going to be the major piece in a special operations exercise. One happened every 15 to 18 months in those days. That was normal. Us, Delta Force, Task Force 160, Navy SEALs, etc. We were at Fort Bliss, Texas. Anybody ever been to El Paso and Fort Bliss? Have any of you ever willingly went back? Oh, nobody, huh? You did? Your grandkids are there. Okay, that's a good reason. Can I help you get them out? I've been there, folks. You know, it ain't a garden spot of the world. It has got a lot better recently with the new things they put in there, so it is. Military there? I'd like to talk to you afterwards, so you can tell them something for me. It'll be kind, don't worry. But anyway, we were there training for this exercise. On August the 10th, I'm informed by my boss that we've been alerted for a real-world mission. Well, that's shocking to me because I'm going to be the major piece in the exercise, and we have a Ranger Ready Force 1 battalion, as it was called then, that was always ready to go. And every battalion, 1st Battalion had it 2 months, 2nd Battalion, 3rd Battalion, so you get it 4 months out of the year in those days, much different today, because now Ranger Battalions deploy about every 6 months. As a matter of fact, 3rd Ranger Battalion has completed their 19th deployment since 9/11. 9/11. 19 times. Well, we're training for this exercise, and my boss tells me that we've been alerted for a real-world mission. And I said, okay, sir, where are we going, what are we going to be doing, and when do we leave? He said, I can't tell you where you're going, I can't tell you what you're going to be doing, but you're leaving tomorrow. Now, I don't know about you, but that's not real good information. So I said, well, sir, when we leave tomorrow, where are we going? He says, you're going to go to Fort Bragg, North Carolina. You're going to link up with forces there. You're going to train for whatever the mission is, and you will deploy from there somewhere. Well, if I'm going to Fort Bragg, North Carolina as a Ranger Battalion, I will be linking up with Delta Force, Task Force 160, etc., because you go to their compound and you train for a mission. That I could piece together. I also had a plus in my favor. I've done missions before, and that experience, as we know, no matter what your profession is, experience is amazingly important. So anyway, he told me that, and then I said, well, sir, what do I take with me? I'm hoping he's going to say, take your entire battalion, because the camaraderie when the whole unit goes is unbelievably important. He said, you'll take one Ranger rifle company and one platoon. You can take just that much. I had about 240 to go. So I knew in the long run I'm going to have the haves and the have-nots, because you all want to be there with each other. And it didn't work out that way. That's not what we did. So anyway, I'm going to take about 240. That helped me, though, because if I'm going to Fort Bragg, I'm going to link up with Delta Force. I know that. He didn't have to tell me. I know we're going to train for this mission. I know I've got 240 people involved. I know what Delta will match with that. They had a whole squadron, which was way less than 240. And then you have all the aviation piece, because we don't go without helicopters. So all of that sort of in my mind fell into place as to what was probably going to happen. But I didn't even know it was still, I didn't know it was a capture-only mission. My boss didn't know that. He wasn't keeping it from me. So anyway, the next thing I say, well, sir, when do we leave? He said, tomorrow morning at 5 a.m. I said, yes, sir. So now I had to make a decision, and I made the decision by myself. The decision was who was going to go. I got three companies, Alpha, Bravo, Charlie. I immediately eliminated my Charlie company because the company commander had only been in command 30 days. He wasn't ready to go to combat. That exercise was going to get him there. So I eliminated Charlie company. So now I got Alpha and Bravo to choose from. I got 50% chance of getting it right. Well, the one advantage I also had was, since I had taken command in February of 1993, I had been a lot of good places with my units. I'd been to Korea for 3 weeks with them right after I took command in February. We went on March the 1st. I had been to Thailand with one of the companies. I had been out and evaluated platoons and stuff. Because that's the only way you know the strengths and weaknesses of the people that are going to be leading is when you get out there and get dirty on the ground with them. Because that's how I learned to lead from General Grange. You've got to do what they do and do it with them, because then you'll know who's what. Because they're all a little different, because nobody's leadership's exactly the same as the other. So anyway, I get to choose now between Alpha and Bravo Company, and basically I chose Bravo Company. I chose Bravo Company not because of the company commander, the captain, not because of the first sergeant, not because of the platoon leaders. I chose it because of the sergeant, first class platoon sergeants. So any of you in here that served in the military and was an NCO, you know what I'm saying. They were the most important people on the face of the earth to me because they had 46 Rangers that belonged to them. And I mean, they belonged to them because I made sure they understood they belonged to them. Because one of the pieces of guidance I gave 2 days after I took command was every platoon sergeant, you will know the first name, last name of every one of your soldiers. You will know if they're married or single, and if they're married, you better know their wife's names, and if they got kids, you better know the kids' names. If they're not married, you better know where mom and dad are at and know their names and know if they got brothers and sisters. They thought I'd lost my ever-loving mind when I told them to do that. But I did it because I wanted them to understand they're not just soldiers, they're your kids. Because you're going to be out there leading them somewhere on a very tough day. I had no idea, but a very tough day. You have to make sure they understand you're there to lead them and make them survive. They thought I was crazy, but I have to admit about 5 years after I retired, I was with some of them. And they told me, yeah, we thought you were crazy to tell us to do that. But just so you know, we thought it so good before it was all over that when we became command sergeant majors ourselves, we made our platoon sergeants do the same thing. I probably thought that was one of the greatest moments when they told me that. See, you got to lead. You don't coddle people. You don't get too close to them, but you got to care about them. Everyone that you're leading, you have to care about. And you got to care about if they're married and the kids that are at home. You have to do that, in my opinion. So anyway, I chose my Bravo Company because of the platoon sergeants, because out of those four platoon sergeants, three of them jumped in Panama with me in 1989. I'd seen them fight the fight before. That's very, very comforting when you've seen them fight the fight. So anyway, I get them in and I tell them that we're going to Fort Bragg. Don't know what the mission is, but we're going on a real-world mission. We were shocked because we thought 1st Ranger Battalion would go since they were Ranger Ready Force 1. But we learned something during Desert Storm when I was at the regiment as the XO up there. We piecemealed the battalion. They needed 220 Rangers to go over and support Delta Force and Navy SEALs during Desert Storm on special ops missions. We pulled that 220 out of the Ranger Ready Force 1 battalion. When we did our after-action report months later, we realized what would have happened if we'd had to send the whole battalion somewhere else. We didn't have a whole battalion. We'd piecemeal part of it. Don't ever do that again. And that's the reason we ended up getting the mission. We just came out of Ranger Ready Force 1 on 1st of August. So August the 10th, I'm told this. August the 11th, we get there. And on August the 12th, we start training for the mission to capture Mohammed Faradi. That's when we found out what the mission was when General Garrison briefed us and told us. So anyway, we start training on August the 22nd. General Garrison, I will tell you, was the finest warfighter I have ever worked for on a mission like that. Ever. Phenomenal man. What I liked about General Garrison, if you were doing good, he probably didn't say anything to you. But if you weren't doing good, he was going to talk to you. I like that because I always knew how I stood with the guy. He was a tremendous trainer, a great leader. Retired as a two-star, lives in Waco, Texas now. Anyway, we get there and it was on August the 22nd. We were ready to go. General Garrison said, we've got a few days before the on-or-about date, so take time to rest and get all your equipment totally squared away. August the 22nd, though, the world changed for us because on August the 22nd, the mission to Somalia was canceled. If you've heard me before say that, it doesn't count. How many people in here knew that mission got canceled? Once again, doesn't that bother you that 22 years later you never knew that? And it did. We got that mission was canceled on August the 22nd. We were told to go back to Fort Bliss, Texas and join the exercise. Delta Force didn't have to go anywhere because they're at home, and the aviators didn't go right away because they took a couple days to drink beer before they went back to Fort Campbell. I know what they did, okay? No, that mission was canceled on August the 22nd, folks. I'm telling you the honest truth. And we packed up and we went back to Fort Bliss, Texas. We got back there and I was getting briefed by my staff on the exercise. We had already put the phones off limits when I went the first time, which was never a signal, because I did that sometime during every deployment. Because if you do it sometime during every deployment, nobody thinks anything different, do they? It's a normal thing. I'm sure the wives back there said, yep, we hadn't heard from him in 2 days. He's done it again. Yep, I did. So we get back there, and I'm sitting there getting briefed on the exercise. Been there about 10 hours. One of my young captains answers the field phone and says, sir, it's for you. I said, who is it? He said, it's a regimental liaison. That's a major that works in my boss's headquarters. And I'm walking over there, and I casually said, calling to say we got to go back. And I said, yeah, what do you need? He said, sir, what are y'all doing? I said, we're breaking down our equipment. He said, stop. The colonel's on his way down to see you. He came down and told me the mission's back on. We've been there 10 hours, and this mission's back on. Well, what happened, I'll tell you very quickly. Madeleine Albright had guidance from President Clinton to go back and tell Boutros-Ghali that we weren't going to do this, because the Clinton administration figured out they weren't smart enough to do it. And there was one very unfortunate thing that affected us, and that was General Colin Powell. General Powell had been the chairman of the Joint Chiefs. He stayed on when the Clinton administration came in because they asked him to, but on August the 1st, he retired. Bad timing for us. I believe had General Powell still been there, there would have been a lot of different answers to what was going to happen. And one of them, there would never have been any indecision with General Powell. I think he was a great military leader, truly. I really do. And I think that was unfortunate for us. So we get the word, and at 7 a.m. the next morning, planes are coming in to pick us up to go back. How did that all happen? Well, President Clinton has sent Madeleine Albright to tell the UN, Boutros-Ghali, we're not going to do the mission yet. Now, Boutros-Ghali looks at Madeleine Albright and said, oh, yes, you are. You stood here in front of everybody, and you committed to do it, and there's nobody else ready to do it. Y'all are going to get this done. Madeleine hustles back to the White House, said, Billy, we got a problem. We've got to do this now, because if we don't, the rest of your term, we won't survive with the United Nations. What's that all called, folks? Politics at its finest, isn't it? And who was the ones having to deal with the other part? Soldiers were. Not a new story, is it, in terms of that? That's exactly what happened. So, we get sent back to Fort Bragg. General Garrison's already gone forward, and we get briefed. Updated. The update was the following. Task Force Ranger has been capped at only 450 people to go. If we had 450, that was good. We had about 552 was the number I recall. We had to cut 102 people out of Task Force Ranger 30 hours before we're going over there. Why? They said it. They didn't want it to look like a buildup similar to Vietnam. When you think about Bill Clinton's background, that's got to irritate you. And unfortunately, General Powell wasn't there. Admiral Jeremiah of the Navy was the acting chairman. I'm sure he tried and they blew him off. General Powell would have never been blown off. Unfortunate timing for us. We have to cut down to 450. I had a full company and one other platoon of 46. That other platoon of 46 sat there the day we left. They didn't go. Do you think that platoon of 46 would have helped at the second crash site when it went down and the people couldn't get to them? Yes, because those 46 could fast rope down there. We didn't have anybody extra running around. That decision alone is one that just absolutely keeps me awake still at night sometimes, because I know my five friends that died at that second crash site would be alive today. I know that. And a couple of them I'd become very close to, Delta guys. Gary Gordon, he and I spent a lot of time together. I would tell you the good part of Gary Gordon's life is his son Ian, who was 6 when he died. His daughter was 4. Ian Gordon is a staff sergeant in 3rd Ranger Battalion today. serving the same company that fought with his father over there, Bravo Company. Ian will go to Delta Selection in a couple of years. And somebody, when I said that one time, said to me, well, it'll be easy for him. After I wanted to slap him in the next week, okay, I didn't. I said, why do you say that? And they said, well, his father. I said, do you realize that because of his father, he'll have it harder than anybody has ever had? Because he's got to live up to the standards of his father. Oh, he'll make it. He will make it because he's good. I promise you. But he's got to live up to a legend. And they will make sure he does. Well, anyway, we adjust. Then the other stupid decision, because these are the stupid ones. There's one, here's two. In special operations, just like SEAL Team Six showed when they got Osama bin Laden, we believe in surprise, speed of action, and violence of action. That really works. We don't have big firepower, but we have it available usually. And when we were going to Somalia, we were going to have it. It's called the AC-130 gunship. Big airplane, flies around the sky, shoots bullets on the ground really good. They have two size bullets. Big ones, little ones. We only need the little ones, okay? That AC-130 was taken away from us. They said it cannot deploy because we're worried about collateral damage. Ever who the idiots were that said that had never looked at a picture of Mogadishu. The whole place was collateral damage, folks. I really think they were trying to make it hard and thinking that maybe General Garrison would say, we can't go do this. Guess what? That ain't going to happen, is it? No. You give us a mission, we're going to get it done. I also will tell you that AC-130 would have saved everybody at that second crash site because they would have drawn their circle around that helicopter when it went down about 200 meters out in every direction. And when the bad guys, like shown in the movie very well, started running towards there in a group of 25 or so, that AC-130 would have eliminated them from God's good earth. I believe the second group would have said, whoa, that didn't go well. But one of them would have been stupid enough to say, oh, we can make it, we'll run faster. You ain't going to run faster than the AC, and they would have got eliminated. Then I believe the third group said, we're going home. I believe that would have saved my friends too, without question. Two stupid decisions that were made for no logical, correct reason. Those decisions killed my friends. I have not accepted it, nor will I ever accept it. And that's the reason you deserve to know. That's the reason, in all honesty, I chose to write that. Because you hadn't heard the whole story. And you deserve to hear the whole story. And I promise you, if there's anything I can do to have this affect the next election, I will do it. Because I don't want soldiers dying because of stupid decisions made by people that don't have a clue about how to operate with the military. And I see things going on today that really reminds me a whole lot of it. And I'm sure many of you sitting here know exactly that. And that's unacceptable to me. We've got the greatest military force on the face of the earth still today. Let them do what they do. And they will do it right every time. And more people will be alive if you let them do what they do. Anyway, that was a whole bunch of things there. I'm just going to show you some slides and pretty well shut up. That gives you an idea that we actually did a total of 7 operations. Some people think the only one we did was the one that obviously the movie was based on. We did 6 before that. We'd already captured one of the very, very key people, Osman Otto. We captured some other people. And on the 3rd and 4th of October, we had 2 more. So we had 3 of the top 5 people next to Adid. Locations throughout Mogadishu. I love it because people say, why did you go to the worst part of town that day? Because the bad guys were there? I mean, think about it. Have you ever seen law enforcement walk into the Hilton Garden Inn and arrest somebody? Not often, huh? Yeah, it doesn't happen often. Bad people are in bad places. Why? Because they want to be an advantage and they put you at a disadvantage if they do that. Very simple. This is a really to talk about numbers. We faced, without question, about 1,000 well-trained fighters, plus or minus some. Where did they come from, these well-trained fighters? They came from the country of Sudan, because the country of Sudan was where a terrorist training camp existed. It was run by Osama bin Laden. He was so happy to find this guy named Mohammed Faradi that wanted to kill Americans, because that's all Osama bin Laden wanted to do. And so he was willing to send people there that we fought. We could tell there was a difference in them and the ragtag Somalis we were fighting, because for one thing, they had a little bit of a uniform that stood out. And also they were in groups of five or six. They weren't doing it independently. So we fought some well-trained fighters. There was less when we finished. The aftermath, we had captured three of the top five people next to Adid. We were making progress. After October 3rd and 4th, we were not allowed to go out again. That right there is a mistake. Anytime you don't finish what you go to do, that sends the rest of the world a message that, oh, you can get them. You kill enough of them, they won't finish. Wasn't our choice. The Somali casualties take the 754, cut it in half, move it to the other side, because a lot of them died later on because the medical care was very poor. Red Cross did the best they could. Task Force Ranger, we total of 17. On October the 3rd and 4th, we lost 16. Six Rangers, five Delta operators, and five aviators. The 17th one was Matt Ryerson, Sergeant First Class Delta Force operator. On October the 7th, after we had a memorial service that day, a mortar round landed in our compound 18 inches behind Matt and killed him after he'd fought through everything on October 3rd and 4th. Great Delta Force operator. He was actually in the convoy with me. So we redeployed, started redeploying the end of October. I started with that and I finished with that. This is truly, to me, what occurred over there, a great story of the ultimate sacrifice. We lost too many, because when you lose one, it's too many. I think we all would agree with that. But I promise you, every one of them that fought over there, we're glad they were there, because they were doing what they're supposed to be doing, and they do it with their buddies on the right and left. And that's the most important thing. I hope I've told you a little bit about me and how strong I believe in what you do and why you're here. And I hope I've sort of filled in a few blanks regarding what really happened over there. And I do that because 22 years ago, when my young Rangers were fighting their butt off, they deserve for you to know. And they want you to know. Thank you. God bless you. And God bless America.